What we have heard and known, what our fathers have told us. Who told us? Our fathers. I want you to see in the scripture that fathers, when they're truly in the right role, in the role of fatherhood as God wants that role to be, fathers are investing the faith in the next generation. And men, that is what we are to do. And it's not to say that that's not there for women to do as well, but I think that oftentimes what happens is when that father is absent, that father figure, the women oftentimes rise up to do that well. But men, we shouldn't be absent in that role. It is vital that we see that in the book of Psalms, that we have the psalmist saying that it is our role as fathers to invest the faith in the next generation, to tell of the goodness of God, to speak of the fact that our God does mighty and awesome works. I want to say that God has been faithful in my life. It is my testimony to know that when my mom was a widow, when I was 6 months old, that God has been good to us and that God watched over us. He is there and he is a father to the fatherless. He is there for the widows. I know. It's my testimony. And I know that God is good. And so I want my children to know that God is good. I want my kids to know that God is there for you so that when they remember their childhood and their parents, they are in the days ahead a parent, and they're in the days ahead in a moment in which they're thinking, I'm facing something that seems impossible. I'm facing something that I don't know what to do. I want my kids who are listening to their dad right now, I want them to know that God is good. He was good to my mom. He was good to my dad. He's been good to their mom and their dad. He'll be good to them. God has been good in days of old. He's still good. He's going to be good in the days ahead. And we need to invest that into the next generation because there's a generation that is here right now that hasn't necessarily heard that from their fathers. And when fathers abdicate that role, again, I'm telling you, the women have done well. But I believe that we have a generation right now in which we are seeing that there's a generation that does not know God in the same way that the generations of old have known God. In fact, I don't believe in our generation we've really seen revival quite like the revivals I read about in the days of Charles Finney, quite like the revivals that I read about that we can see and the things that were happening in the days of John Wesley. We have guests here from England. Epworth is right there. You can go and stand in the pulpit of John Wesley, a man who would get on his knees. I believe it was 4 a.m. in the morning. When he would get on his knees. He had a brother by the name of Charles, who was a hymn writer, wonderful minister in his own right. And John Wesley was amazing because until his dying day, he did not stop going on horseback everywhere he could go to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. I knelt there in Epworth. I was there in his home. I wanted to kneel in the same place where I knew that a lion of the faith had stood up and believed for England to be strong in the things of God. I'm still believing for that. I'm believing for England to know Jesus like the days of John Wesley. I'm believing for the United States of America to know Jesus like the days where we saw Jonathan Edwards and others that were standing up with conviction and power and with no compromise at all. We must do that, men. We must stand up. Women, we must stand up. Fathers, we must stand up. What do? We invest in a new generation to say, you can see things that are greater things, for God is not outdone by what he's been doing in the past. He can do it again. We need to see it. 9/11, what happened? Buildings went down. We saw airplanes going into buildings. We saw the terrorism and all of that. What happened with churches? Churches were filled for about a month or two till people thought, well, I feel a little safer now. They don't come into the church quite in the same way. People come in a moment of crisis. It's not good enough to have faith that only is faith in moments of crisis. We must stand at all times and recognize it is time for the next generation to be invested in. How will that happen, dads? How will that happen, those of you that will be fathers, unless we stand up encouraged to do that? Let's look in 1 Samuel for a moment. In 1 Samuel, we see a story that is familiar to many of us. It's the story of how a man by the name of Eli, who's a priest, is investing in a young man by the name of Samuel. And we see this investment. We know that Samuel's mother dedicated him from birth to the Lord, and now we see that Eli, and I'm going to set up the story, we won't go into the fullness of it here, But Eli, as we come out of this story, will actually teach this young Samuel how to hear the voice of God, how to respond to, rather, the voice of God. Let's look in the third chapter of 1 Samuel and then go 1 through 8. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. Again, just a boy. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel. Samuel answered him, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." But Eli said, I did not call you. Go back and lie down." So he went and lay down. Again the Lord called Samuel. Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." And "My son," Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel a third time, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." Now again, there's a tremendous story here. You'll want to read the rest of that. If that's an unfamiliar story to you, you'll want to know the rest of that story and what happens there. But the point that I want to make this morning on this Father's Day is how fascinating it is that this Eli, who's a father figure, a mentor to Samuel, that when Samuel hears the voice of God, he thinks it's his father figure. There's something so familiar in the voice that he thinks it's Eli. Now, it's important for us to see, dads, future dads, it's important for us to recognize that we in so many ways represent God to those that are the next generation. We as righteous men need to be able to see that there will be people that will watch us and will equate fatherhood, Father God, with their earthly dad.